Good morning, children of the Most High God. Praise the living God. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. First and foremost, Lord God, may you bless us this morning as you've already blessed us with opening our eyes, having breath in our lungs, and being able to just glorify you with our life today. May Jesus Christ live in us, through us, by us, and for us, and for the kingdom of glory. May souls be won today to the kingdom of God. May the power of darkness be trampled underfoot. May we stand as children of light, as the light that's on a hill that is shining bright for the Lord Jesus Christ himself. Lord God, may this short sermon be just filling and educational to each and every brother and sister listening to it. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Good morning. God bless you. God is good. He's good all the time, in the good, in the bad, in the happy, in the sad, because all things work together for the good of those who love the Lord. So if you are going through something right now, ask yourself, is this because of you? Is it the enemy? Is it God? But whatever it is of the three, the Bible says if you are a child of the Most High God, according to Romans 8:28, that all things work together for the good of those who love the Lord and who are called according to his purpose. So if there is things going on bad right now in your life, raise your hands to God and ask, Lord God, is this me? Did I bring this trial or this situation on myself? And if I did, Lord God, cleanse me, heal me, guide me, restore me, and forgive me, that I may come back into the glory and the fold of Jesus Christ. And what you have to understand is that darkness cannot overpower the light. The light will always overpower the darkness. And if God is allowing a test in your life, then pass the test and remember why. Don't go, God, why are you not listening to me? God, why can I not hear you? What you have to understand is that the teacher is quiet in the test, which allows me to come to this understanding. I was reading this yesterday before I was getting ready to go to work and then go to San Quentin last night, which was powerful in San Quentin last night, man. Every man I sat with, there was five of them, and I think it was three or four of them was just in prayer. And then this news, I don't know if it was a news, these people are doing a documentary on this one youngster that's like 6'6", and the first thing he said when he sat down was, Pastor, I need prayer. And it was a blessing to pray with him. And after the prayer, we was doing the interview because we helped him to get jobs and stuff. They was recording it. And so the lady, after she did, you know, he walked away because they're 15-minute intervals. She came up and explained to me that, you know, this kid has action at, you know, getting this whole documentary done on, because he wants to play basketball. So I was telling him about humility, right? Because he asked for a prayer of humility. And I said, when you ask for that type of prayer for patience and humility, God sends a lot of stuff. And right when I said that, it was interesting because the warden came over and you could see how his whole demeanor and character changed. And I said, you just asked for prayer for this. We have to understand, in the body of Christ, watch this, you have to understand, when God is transforming your heart, when he is circumcising your heart, when he is pruning you, he will allow people, even Christians, to come around to kind of sand that down, to show you that we're supposed to still walk in love, even with those who are not walking in love with us at that moment. But to always understand that it's not always the enemy, because sometimes God will send people and things our way to see how we react in our heart, because what comes out the mouth first is formed in the mind, then enters in the heart, it comes out the mind. The Bible says to guard the heart, for out of it flows the issues of life. So anyway, I just wanted to share this small little encouraging message, because I, for the last couple of sermons I did, was on baby Christians and mature Christians. And yesterday I was reading this, don't know why, only God knows. And so today I made sure that I read it again. And I, just as I just started reading, it was like, share this. Go and share this right now as you're reading it. Because I heard a couple of good messages this morning. Galatians chapter 4. Now I want us to get the breakdown of this, because I'm going to try to get it as a baby Christian, but also to understand our, excuse me, our walk as a Christian, right? So Galatians chapter 4, verse 1. We're starting at verse 1, and I think we're going to go to verse 3. It says, "Now I say that the heir, as long as he is a child or she is a child, differeth nothing from a servant." Now what he's saying is that even though we're an heir to the throne of grace, because we are still a child, we are just like a servant still. And he's explaining why. We need to understand these are steps as we go in our walk and our journey with God. They're steps that we take. A lot of people jump into God and they get on fire and they get, you know, they get so caught up and all they want to do is run and do all this stuff. It's like, hold on, brother. Hold on, sister. You haven't even been prepared for the ditches, the pits, the falls, the temptations, the sins that are going to come your way. So again, verse 1. "Now I say that the heir, as long as he or she is a child, differeth nothing from a servant, though he or she be Lord of all." Meaning he was talking to in these times was that this king, even though he was a child, he was still the heir to the throne. But right now he's a child and he needs to remain a child because at this stage of his life, he's not nowhere close to being ready to be used by to be king, right? And it's like us, when we're a baby Christian, we're not ready to run out there and do the will of God because we yet to even understand the will of God, yet to ever to even really understand the voice of the Holy Spirit. You got Christians that have been saved for many years who don't really trip on their strong relationship with the Holy Spirit because all they do is Jesus, 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 not realizing Jesus is sitting at the right hand of the Father, and Jesus sent his Spirit, which is the Holy Spirit, the comforter, the teacher, the corrector, the guider, the leader inside of us to be able to get to these places. Verse 2, but is under the heir, right? The child, the heir, but verse 2, but is under tutors and governors until the time appointed of the Father. Even so, we, when we were children, were in bondage under the elements of the world. Verse 4, but when the fullness of the time was come, God sent forth his son, made of a woman, made under the law, right? What's going on here is that, what I want you to get in this little small segment here is that we get saved and we're on this journey. The Bible says that we have many tutors, right? It says tutors and governors. There's people that oversee our walk. The moment we fall out of under that covering, right, the church is responsible for you. So the church sees you. The church is walking with you. You got elders, you know, with the women, you got strong women. They become like mothers. The fathers become like the older men become like fathers to the men, and they guide us. They teach us. They teach us not to fall, not to sin, where to err, how to follow the Bible. So as we're growing, sometimes we go astray, like the prodigal son. The prodigal son decided, I want to go out into the world and see the world for myself. And the father's like, you really don't understand. You're just going to go live in the world. And he already knew what was going to happen, but the son didn't. Because he was, even though he was still like an heir to this pastor, he had to understand where he was. So in the process of that, what I want us to understand in this walk, you know, we got Christians that have been in the walk for 10 years, but they still seem like they're children. And the reason why a lot of that happens is because they fall away from the covering. They don't want to listen to the correction of the pastor. You know, their conviction aside from the Holy Spirit is getting lower and lower and lower because they're not paying attention to it. You're still in error. None of that error, even the prodigal son, even when he went astray, the father was always looking for him. He never lost his position. And when he did return back home, like a backslider, we returned back home. The father was so grateful because he knew that his son that was lost is now found, that was blind can now see. He seen that his son understood the error of his ways. And as Christians, when we get convicted by the Holy Spirit, and like in Galatians 1, it says, those of you who are spiritual, restore such a one in error but do it in love. So it comes back to the love walk of how we correct and guide our baby Christians, right? Because the mature Christian's job is to guide the baby Christian. And what he's saying here, and I just want to read it straight through, because like I said, I wasn't really trying to do no long out sermon, but this touched me, because as a man of God, I've been serving God for 18 years, and I'm watching the elevations that God is doing. The Bible says promotion comes from above. It doesn't come from man. It comes from above. And what God has been doing in me, through me, by me, and for me, and for the kingdom of God, through Saved by Grace, he's bringing recognition. You know, these men in the prisons yesterday, they go, wow, you know, because I go every time. So, you know, our commitment is important when we're feeding the body of Christ. And every one of those men that sat down, they sat down to hear from Jesus, not from Ronnie. Okay, again, Galatians chapter 4, verse 1. Now I say that the heir, as long as he or she is a child, differeth nothing from a servant, though he or she be Lord of all, but is under tutor and governors until the time appointed of the father. Even so, we, when we were children, were in bondage under the elements of the world. Meaning that even though when we was baby Christians, we were still caught up in the things of the world. You know, you got Christians that are still baby Christians, been doing it for 10 years. Why? Because they didn't stay in their Bible. They didn't stay in their word. They didn't listen to conviction. They weren't being corrected of the errors of their ways. And when they weren't being corrected of the errors of their ways, they did what they wanted to do because they used a favorite statement. God is still working on me. Don't judge me. They did everything to stay in the bondages of the world instead of being separated from the bondages of the world to grow in Christ. The Bible says from faith to faith and glory to glory. So we have to understand that even as mature Christians, seasoned Christians, people in leadership, we have to understand the role that we play, but we also have to understand what a baby Christian is, how a baby Christian is walking. And so the Bible says sometimes you got to push them out to church and let them really get the understanding of the error of their ways. Just like the prodigal son, he had to be, hey, go ahead, go into the world. I'm going to leave you alone. You got to do that on your own. And God will let you go because it's your choice. But what I wanted us to understand is that, you know, let's not judge so strictly and severely those who are still baby Christians, regardless of the amount of time that they had in the word. We have to come to them with love and share your testimony. Share the falls that you make. You know, as a pastor, I always share what I've done wrong on here so people can understand. And I'm just in need of Jesus, the Holy Spirit, conviction, correction, and guidance is the next man or woman. Because it's our testimony that strengthens people, especially when baby Christians are people that have been in the word for many years and not where we're at. They're like, you know, but even they sin and even they fall short. But they look at the humility, they look at the conviction, and then they look at the integrity, and then they look at the areas that we're still growing. Ain't nobody perfect in this walk. And the problem with judging is people want to judge you for what you do and what you say without actually knowing why you did it or said it. If you sit with someone and ask them why they did or said what they did, then the Bible says be quick to listen and slow to speak and slow to anger, because as that person is confessing to you and talking to you and telling you why they did what they did or said what they said or even thought what they thought, the Spirit of God, the Holy Spirit, the tutor, the comforter, the instructor, the guider, the leader is now telling you what to tell that person in love that will bring conviction and restoration to that person to help them grow and mature in the word. I really believe that God is talking to somebody as well as he's talking to me about who we are and how we are to conduct ourselves as the body of Christ and as Christians. So this is how we do it. This was just a tidbit. Happy Friday to you. And, you know, Memorial Day is this weekend. Be safe out there. Enjoy your life as a Christian. Don't get caught up in all the worldly functions, but get caught up in Christianity. Wherever you go, whatever you do, let the light of Christ shine through you to bring somebody to the kingdom. When we go into the dark world, we are coming as light. People are supposed to say, look at that man, look at that woman, look at that couple, look at that marriage, look at that family. What is so different about them? I want what they got. They're supposed to want what we have. And that conviction sets them free to come to us. That's why the Bible says Christians have liberty. Liberty means to be liberal, to be a Christian, and to walk in the kingdom of God. So Heavenly Father, I thank you this morning for this small but sweet but tender message that I can't wait to even hear again myself, because it was not me talking, but it was you talking, Lord God. And I heard a lot of messages in there for myself, Lord God. And today, Lord God, allow your presence to be felt in me, through me, by me, and for me. Allow your words to be heard in me, through me, by me, and for me. Allow your presence to sit and just change people, because it is the Spirit of God that changes spirit. One plants, one waters, but it is God. It is God and God only, through the Holy Spirit, who brings the increase. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you.